So good evening, everyone. Welcome to Shankaraya's Academy Expert Talk Series. Today, we have with us All India Rank 89 of UPSC Civil Service Examination 2019, Shri Nitin K. Biju, who has secured the rank in his third attempt. So he has attended prelims two times before. Though he cleared in the first attempt, he missed the mains exam by just 2 marks. Without getting disappointed, he gave more attempts and he tried. Finally, he has succeeded in becoming an All India topper this year, and he has secured a very high rank of All India Rank 89 this year. So we are extremely delighted to have you on board, Mr. Nitin. And Mr. Nitin today will be sharing his strategies about primary as well as main examination, how he overcame various challenges during his preparation phase. And we are sure that it is going to be of immense help for all the aspirants who are in their various stages of preparation or who are planning to appear for this exam in the upcoming years. So we welcome you, Mr. Nitin, to this program. And also we welcome all the attendees. We are awaiting a very productive session where you can ask your doubts also towards the end of the session. First, Mr. Nitin will give a talk about his preparation strategies. So handing over to you, Mr. Nitin. Thank you.
Thank you. First of all, let me thank Shankaraya's Academy for providing me this opportunity to have a webinar. I'll initially briefly discuss about my journey in civil services. Later, in the second part of the session, I'll be telling the strategy how to prepare individually prelims, mains, and even interview. And after that, in the third part of the session, we'll move towards the question and answer session. So let us start with my basic information. So my name is Nitin K. Biju. I am from Pathanamthitta district in Kerala. Till 12th, I have studied in Jawahar Navodaya Vidyalaya, Pathanamthitta. After the schooling, I shifted to Bangalore for my graduation. My graduation is in Electronics and Communication Engineering. So after shifting, I studied in RNS Institute of Technology, Bangalore. So my the idea of preparing for civil services came to me during my graduation days. In my first and second year, I used to just listen to stories about various civil servants, the good work they are doing and all. And I was able to talk with Haritha V. Kumar, who was a first rank holder during those years. So after that, I thought, why don't I try for civil services? So I started the preparation in my third year of graduation. When I was in my sixth semester, I decided to join online, weekend classes, and I started my preparation there. But since it was during the graduation period, I couldn't balance both civil services as well as engineering, because engineering in itself is a tough subject. And in the final year, I was a bit more focused on the final year projects. And so my actual study started after my graduation in 2016. 2017 was supposed to be my first attempt. I started preparing it, and I was actually confident that I'll be able to do it in my first attempt. And luckily, I was able to clear the prelims. After clearing the prelims, I wrote my mains, and as Arunlal has told you, I have missed my mains by 2 marks. So there was a lot of disappointment at that point of time. But when the marks came out, I was a bit happy because I didn't miss by a big margin. I missed by a very small margin. So then I understood that if I'm able to focus back on my studies and give an attempt again, then I'll definitely be able to clear it. So with that confidence, I wrote my second prelim. In 2018, I wrote the prelims. But again, at that point, in that prelims also, I missed my prelims by 4 marks. So I didn't clear the prelims. So again, that was another disappointment. But now I feel that the failures had taught me a lot of lessons. So then after that, I understood that I had to focus properly on prelims as well as the mains. And I actually got a long year to prepare because since I didn't clear the prelims only, I got a long year to prepare. So at that point of time, I was able to prepare very nicely. And I gave this year prelims. And in 2019, I gave the prelims. I had high marks in prelims because I cleared the Indian Forest Service prelims also. So that was so, and I wrote the mains of both civil services as well as the forest services, and I cleared both of the exams. Both the mains also I was able to clear. But in February, the Indian Forest Service interview had happened, and I went to Delhi. But when the results came, I was not able to clear the Indian Forest Service examination. Then later, the COVID happened. My interview of civil services was postponed. Initially, it was supposed to be on April 3rd, the last day. But it was postponed, and the new date came to be July 21st. Then I went to Delhi. So that was the time of COVID. So traveling to Delhi was itself a difficult thing for me at that point of time. So I reached Delhi. Then the interview board was PK Joshi sir's board. So it was a very different kind of interview, because the aspirants were everyone who came for interview were using face mask, face shield and all. So it was a different interview experience altogether. Anyway, luckily, I'm glad that I'm able to clear the examination with 89th rank. This is about my brief journey of civil services. So now let us focus back on the strategies. I'll be giving some detailed strategy on how I prepared for prelims, mains, and the interview. Now, coming to the prelims preparation, I would say that for prelims, there are three main pillars for prelims. One is the static part, one is the current affairs, and the other one is the test series. So when I say the static part, I mean the static subjects like polity, history, ancient, medieval, and modern. Then coming to economy is there, art and culture is there, environment is there. So these are the static part which I am telling. So then current affairs, what I did was like the focus was on the last 1 year of current affairs. So that also we have to do. And third aspect is the test series. Okay. So test series, we have to be writing a lot of tests during the course of preparation, because it is not just the knowledge part, but the skill is also equally important in civil services for clearing the prelims especially. Now coming to the static part. So here, one thing which I want to tell you is, like, if you are a beginner, then start with the basic NCRTs. It is preferable that if you have the time, then start with the NCRTs of 6th to 12th. Try to cover all the NCRTs. But if you have paucity of time, then I would suggest you to focus on NCRTs in a priority basis. That is, the NCRTs of history and geography becomes very important from the 6th standard itself. Okay, so the 6th, 7th, 8th NCRTs of history, there are a lot of questions which are being asked from those histories, those NCRTs. Okay, so that is one aspect which I want to tell you. Focus, start with the basic NCRTs in case of static subjects. And after finishing the NCRTs, focus on a standard book. The standard book should be at maximum one or two. There should not be more than that, more than one or two. I prefer just one standard book per subject, apart from the NCRTs. So this is one area which you have to focus on. Because I have seen many people who try to shift between different books. Like for example, if you consider take the example of history, I've seen various people who shift, first start with Bipin Chandra for modern India, then they shift to Spectrum, then they shift to another book. So these kind of a shifting between the various standard books, that is not a good strategy. So I would suggest you to focus on one standard book and continuously revise the same standard book again and again. So that is one aspect which I want to tell you. Now, I will just briefly mention the sources, the books, the important books which I use for my civil service preparation. Now, coming to the main pillars of static prelims, one is the polity and one is the modern India. For polity, as everyone knows, the main book is Lakshmikant. Lakshmikant, Indian Polity by Lakshmikant, is the most important book for polity. So that book must be studied. It should not be missed. Apart from this Lakshmikant, you can also go through the NCRTs, especially the class 11th and 12th NCRTs with respect to polity. It is very much useful. Like, they have given very good, there are very good NCRTs based on various ideas, like various keywords on our constitution. For example, there is an NCRT which discusses about federalism, equality, fraternity. So these kind of keywords as a chapter. So this will help you to get more conceptual clarity in the polity. So this NCRTs, 11th and 12th NCRTs plus Indian Polity by Lakshmikant will be more than sufficient. Now coming to the second most important pillar of prelims, that is modern history. So in case of modern history, I told you we have to start from class 6th NCRT itself. So class 6th NCRT, 6, 7, 8, then preferably you can directly jump to 12th NCRT, the theme. So here also, if you try to subdivide, the 6th NCRT is based on ancient India, the 7th NCRT is based on medieval India, and in 8th there are two NCRTs, both of them are based on modern India. And even coming to themes also, theme 1, 2 and 3 actually deals with ancient, medieval and modern India. So these NCRTs plus the standard book, I have preferred Bipin Chandra, there is a small book of Bipin Chandra. Not the fat one, okay. It is a small book of Bipin Chandra. It's actually it is actually the copy of the NCRT, the old NCRT. So that is a really good book for modern history. So you can either choose Bipin Chandra or Spectrum, but ensure that you choose only one and stick to it. Now coming to the sources of economy, in case of economy, I had actually preferred very less books. Like I didn't even go for a standard book, to be honest. So what I did was I started with the NCRTs. I started with the NCRTs of class 11th NCRT is there. It is about Indian economic development. So that is a very good NCRT, especially for the mains. And in class 12, there is an NCRT called Introduction to Macroeconomics. So that was the sole and the main source which I used for economy. So that NCRT is very small, as well as it is very knowledge stacked also. So if you are able to understand that NCRT and revise it multiple times, you will definitely be able to get a grip on the economy, the subject called economy. So apart from this, if you have some issues with understanding the basic concepts, there are many YouTube videos on economy. For example, I had referred to Mrimal economy videos also. So these kind of help from YouTube can also be taken. So these were my, and see, what I would tell you is like, how do you understand whether you have studied sufficient enough or not? For this, what you have to do is, you have to practice mock test after a particular subject. So assume you finished the polity, Indian polity you have completed. Then what you have to do is, you have to write a mock test on Indian polity and see how the marks is. So if you are getting sufficient enough marks, then you don't have to go for my like other sources, especially in case of economy also it's the same. So I referred only this macroeconomy NCRT and the Mrinal videos. Then I came to know that and I wrote a mock test. Then I understood that I don't have to refer a standard book because I'm getting sufficient enough marks in the mock test. I'm able to attend the questions. So I didn't go for multiple sources there. So this is regarding economy. And coming to another very important subject called environment. So in case of environment, again, like polity has Lakshmikant, in case of environment, the only book is Shankar Rai's Academies, the book on environment. So that book you can definitely prefer. So that should be your primary source. Apart from this NCRT, class 12, biology, NCRT, last four chapters can be dealt, it can be studied. And apart from this, ensure that if there is any areas which are missing in this from these two books, then definitely you should go to internet and just check for it. For example, there are some areas in environment where UPSC is continuously asking questions from the biosphere reserves, the national parks, etc. Right. So what I did for this is I made an A4 sheet where I'll be having a list of all this, like one A4 sheet where a list of the biosphere reserves are there and the state to which it belongs to, and another A4 sheet where the list of the national parks. There are around 104 national parks in the country. A list of all the national parks and the state which it belongs to, and categorize it state-wise. And after that, you should be able to make some kind of a mnemonic so that you will be remembering the national parks. And make a list of all such things. For example, there are wetlands in the country, the important wetlands, the Ramsar sites there, the World Heritage sites, so tiger reserves in India, elephant reserves in India. So make an A4 sheet which has a list of all these stuff. So this will be very much handy for you to revise. So that is all about environment. Apart from environment, you have art and culture. In case of art and culture also, NCERT is a very good source. Introduction to Indian Art, I think it is in class 11th or 12th. So that is a very good book for preparation for prelims. Apart from that, standard book is there, Nitin Sinkhania is there. So these two sources will be sufficient. So that's what I'm telling, like try to limit the sources, the books to one or two and try to revise it multiple times, right? So apart from this, which others, like geography is there. In case of geography also, ensure that you start with all the NCERTs starting from the 6th standard itself. So 6th to 12th, all NCERTs should be dealt with. So actually, apart from NCERTs, I didn't go to any other sources for geography. That is one thing. Like, although people recommend G.C. Leong and all, I have that book, but I couldn't study it. So I felt that for geography, NCERTs are sufficient. Apart from NCERTs in geography, another area which you should focus is the Atlas. The Atlas you have to separately prepare. So what I used to do was, I used to prepare the Atlas, both the map of India as well as the world. So first learn to draw an India map. Learn to draw an India map and try to mark all the important geographical features of it. The rivers, the mountains, the major cities, all these kind of things you should be studying thoroughly. And apart from this, it is preferable to focus on those areas, the global area, the world map, which is in use now. For example, West Asia was mostly in news throughout the year. So, and UPSC had asked questions from West Asia continuously. So you should be definitely knowing the map of West Asia, the seas which are there, the countries, the which country borders which other country, the bordering countries of different seas like Mediterranean Sea, Black Sea. So these kind of facts you should be thorough with. And ASEAN is another region which is mostly in use. So you should be able to draw a diagram, draw a map of the ASEAN countries with the exact borders. Okay. So this is how I used to study for the maps. Then apart from this, so I think I have discussed most of the static subjects. Even if there is one or two subjects left, just try to understand the philosophy which I am trying to say. Minimum books and maximum revision. So this is the important aspect related to static part. Now coming to current affairs. So we have discussed about one pillar of prelims. The second pillar is the current affairs. Under the current affairs, what you have to do is, you have to read the Hindu newspaper daily. That is a must. You have to read it continuously for 1 year. So I don't recommend making notes out of it because it will become bulky again. And I'll discuss a note making strategy separately when I'm discussing about me. So read the Hindu newspaper continuously. Apart from that, you should be, I use one monthly magazine. The magazine can be from any institute. So there are very much qualified current affairs magazines which are available in the market. So any one magazine, but the, again, here the main area which you should focus is to stick to that one particular magazine and revise it again and again. So again, the same minimum materials and maximum revision. So that becomes more important in case of current affairs also. Here also I have seen many aspirants who are doing a mistake by trying to
I hope I'm audible now. So I've seen many students who are actually going behind daily current affairs, after that going to monthly current affairs. Then when the prelims is near, a lot of materials will again come in the market and people tend to go behind those materials also. So this this kind of a strategy should be avoided. Here what happens is you are not able to revise the one magazine which you have studied throughout the year. Hello, am I audible? Arunal, am I audible? Can you? Hello?
Yeah, you are audible. Please continue.
Okay. So fine. So here also what I would say is, the same strategy, like minimum materials and maximum revision. So don't go behind multiple materials which will keep on coming in the market. Whatever current affairs magazine which you were following, try to follow the same. Okay. So this is another area. Now coming to the third area, third pillar of prelims is the test series. So when you are attending the test series, you have to focus on two things. Okay, like usually everyone focus write the test series, keeping in mind that the content should be mugged up, right? But that is not the main thing. But you have to ensure that the technique of writing the prelims, should be you have to have a technique. Okay, for example, in my case, my technique of writing attempting a prelims paper was as follows. Initially, I would at least go through three rounds of revision, going through the paper. So in the first round, what I will be doing is I'll be marking the answers which I am 100% sure of. Yeah, 100% sure of. So that might come to around 25 to 30 questions in the first round. But along with that, I'll be just eliminating some options. There will be some options where you will be. You are sure that this is not the option, and you will be able to eliminate one or two options. So, I think the voice is not.
Can you please hold that mic little bit? One second, he's adjusting the voice. One second, I think Mr. Nitin is reconnecting.
I hope I am clear now.
It's better now. Please continue.
Fine. So, coming to the technique of the test series. So, what you have to focus is, you have to have the technique of the test series where you will be attending the paper multiple rounds. So, in the first round, focus only on the questions which you are 100% sure of. Second round, you have to focus on those questions where you are actually guessing, and that guessing should be informative. Either you should be able to eliminate one or two options, then only you should guess on that answer. Try to ensure that you don't guess without any information regarding that, without any elimination of any of the options. Because I've seen, like, even I used to do a mistake in my prelims that in some questions, even though we don't know the answer, even though we are not able to eliminate some of the options, but still we feel that option C is the answer, even though I'm not able to eliminate option A, B and D. So that is something called the intuition is coming. Intuition is telling that you should attend this. Like, even though I'm not able to eliminate it, any of the option, the intuition says that mark it. So in my third attempt, I actually try to avoid this kind of intuitive guessing without any information. So that actually saved me from getting some of the negative marks. So this is one area which I want to tell you. So practicing this technique of test series, that is the most important aspect of what you have to focus on when you are attending the mock test of the institute. Okay. And thus attending the mock test is very much important, because if you don't attend the mock test, then you will not be having that technique, the technique of the mock test, technique of writing the actual prelims. Okay. Also, try to give the mock test in the actual exam-like environment. Don't try to just read the question and read the synopsis, then learn it like that. Don't try to do that. Attend a mock test in the exam-like situation itself. So these are the three main pillars of prelims. And coming to not making for prelims, I actually didn't make much notes for prelims, because if you start making notes from the standard books like Polity of Lakshmikant or Shankar Rai's Academy and all, so then it will become again bulky. So what you can do is, you can use a highlighter. You can use a highlighter and keep marking on the textbook itself. And the note making will be very much limited to what the things which I have told earlier, like the national park, the biosphere reserves, and the reports which are being continuously asked, etc. So another aspect which I would like to tell, like many people miss for the prelims preparation, is that the previous year questions are not being solved. Along with solving the mock test of the academies, you should also ensure that the previous year questions of the actual UPSC exam is also being solved. So the benefits of this is two. One is that you will understand that UPSC tends to repeat some of the areas, repeat questions from some of the areas. So you will be able to read those particular areas. For example, if I in my prelims in 2019, I did the previous year question analysis, and I found that UPSC keeps on asking questions about biosphere reserves and national parks. So what I did, as I told you, I made a list of all the national parks and I read it continuously, and I was very much thorough with that. And two questions were about national parks in the national parks and biosphere reserves in the 2019 prelims. So I was able to easily attend two questions from that area. Also, I came to know while analyzing the previous year paper that UPSC keeps on asking questions on schedules of the Indian Constitution. So I prepared the schedules of the Indian Constitution. So that is a very easy topic. So I prepared it, and this year in 2019, two questions again were from the schedules of the Indian Constitution. So easily I was able to attend four questions. Four questions means 8 marks. I was able to increase 8 marks just because of the reason that I analyzed the previous year questions. So you also should be able to analyze the previous year questions along with giving the mock tests. Also, you'll be able to gauge your performance in the actual UPSC exam also if you are giving the previous year questions. So these are some of the areas which I wanted to cover with respect to prelims. If you have any doubt regarding the prelims, you can ask me during the question and answer session. Now, let us move to the mains examination. So mains, I would say mains examination is the most important aspect of the UPSC examination, because 1750 marks, so it contributes to a very big percentage of the rank, and the actual exam ranking will contribute to your ranking. So for me, the most important part of the exam was the UPSC mains examination. Though, and this is the area where the luck is the minimal. Luck is the minimal. What I believe is that UPSC mains is all about hard work. If you have done a lot of hard work, then you will definitely clear the mains. So you can actually get to know whether you will clear the mains or not purely through hard work. Okay. Now, coming to UPSC mains, my strategy was something like this. Focus completely on the syllabus. Okay, don't go away from the syllabus. Have a printout of the syllabus in front of you and try to analyze the keyword, each keyword which is mentioned in the syllabus. On each keyword, you should be having micro notes. So when I say micro notes, what I mean is, consider an example of a topic in syllabus, e-governance. Okay, so I'll be having one-page notes on e-governance. So in that, what I would be writing is, I'll be writing e-governance, the definition of that. So what is meant by e-governance? So it is something like including the information and communication technology, ICT, in the governance process. So that will be a definition. I'll be writing some examples and case studies which are related to e-governance. So I'll be making a note, one-page note about e-governance, the successes of it, the challenges which are there. So I'll be having some, and I'll be writing only the keywords. I won't explain it in sentences, complete sentences to send out. We just need some keywords related to that particular keyword in the syllabus. In this manner, you'll be covering a lot of syllabus. Okay, covering all the keywords in the syllabus. Here, the internet was a main source for me. So what I would do is, I would just search in internet, e-governance UPSC. And a lot of materials will come in the internet. So, and I'll just select one of those, and I'll stick to that, and I'll be making notes on it. And here also, very minimal notes, one-page notes on every keyword in the syllabus. So the entire GS preparation, you should be having a maximum of 50 to 60 page notes. Maximum, it can go to 70, 75, not more than that. I'm telling for the entire GS papers, GS1, GS2, GS3, and GS4 included, all of them some 75 page of papers. Okay. In my case, I had only 20 page notes for GS1, 20 pages for GS2. 20 pages for GS3 and around 15 pages for GS4, right? So this was my strategy of note making for mains, and note making is very much important for mains, because whatever you make in that notes, you will be able to replicate in the exam. That will save a lot of time in the exam. Okay, so that's why note making is very much important. So this was my GS strategy, and try to continuously write mock tests for mains also, because for mains, what matters is answer writing practice. Along with quality of the answers, the quantity is also a must in mains answer writing. So here, try to write as much as mock tests during those 3 months between prelims and mains. I had actually written around 30 to 40, at least 30 mock tests in those 3 months. Okay. So, and while writing the mock test, what you have to focus is a completion of the paper. Try to attempt all the 20 questions, even though you don't know a question. Try to write something which is relevant. See the keyword and try to write something which is relevant in those in that answer. Okay. So this is one thing which you have to focus on. So this was my G strategy. And coming to the book list remains the same. But you have to prepare extra for the extra subjects in mains. Like in mains, there are some extra subjects like internet security, disaster management and all, right? So for this, again, internet was my main source. And coming to the essay strategy. Essay is one very important subject because of two reasons. One is that it is a very easy subject to score. It is a very easy subject to score. If you have put in a bit of effort, you will get the result in a very fast manner compared to GS and all. GS, how much ever we study, we might get stuck at 110, 115 marks and all. But coming to essay, it can go till 150, 160 and all. So that is why essay is very much important. Also, the variability of the marks in essay is more. In GS, mostly everyone will be getting around the same marks. But when it comes to essay, a person can get 100 also, a person can get 150, 160 also. So a variability of 50 to 60 marks, you can achieve there if you are well prepared in essay. So coming to essay also, my strategy was to be more original in case of essay. Don't try to follow a mechanical approach. So there are many people, many answers, like even in my initial first attempt also, I tried to follow a mechanical approach where I usually follow a pestle approach. Like you might have already heard of it, like political, economical, social, technological. So this pestle kind of approach I used to follow in my first attempt. But in this attempt, what I did is I tried to be more original with my essay. I focused on what exactly is asked in the question. Okay, what are the keywords? The keywords, and I try to prepare, like think about it for 10 minutes, prepare some points on it, and I try to be very original in my essay, quoting personal examples also. So this is another aspect, and so regarding essay, one more very important aspect regarding essay is that you should be learning to write a philosophical essay, because in 2018, many people got less marks in essay because they asked a philosophical essay without any options for that. Like in that section, all essays were philosophical. So there also, you should be ready to write a philosophical essay as well as an essay which is similar to the general study. So these two aspects you should focus on essay. And apart from this, optional. In case of optional, I guess many of you might be beginners here. So I will just briefly tell about how to choose an optional, then how to study the optional subject. So how to choose an optional? In my case, my optional is public administration. So how I choose the optional was based on my interest on the subject. So what I used to do was I just went through the syllabus of various optional subjects. And after reading the syllabus, I even saw the previous year questions of it. And after that, what I focused was I just took a book on that optional subject and I tried learning 2-3 pages out of it. So when I did this, I felt that public administration is a really interesting subject. So based on my interest, I chose public administration. So also apart from that, some other reasons were that the PABAD was actually a very concise subject, which I would be able to finish it in 5 to 6 months. So this was another consideration. But predominantly, the consideration of choosing the optional should be purely based on the interest. Now, how to prepare the optional? Ideally, you should try to finish your optional by December. Assume the prelims is in June. Assuming the prelims is in June. Try to finish the optional by December, maximum Jan. So apart from that, don't focus much on optional. Then try to do it after the prelims. So this was my strategy. I try to finish my optional by Jan to Feb maximum. So in this manner, you'll be a bit confident about your mains and you can completely focus on the prelims in those 3-4 months before the prelims examination. And so this is regarding optional. Here also, the answer writing practice which you do in the GS, general studies, will actually help you to do well in the optional subjects also. And one important aspect which related to optional is try to differentiate your optional answers from a normal GS answer. The questions will look the same. The questions of public administration, if I take that example, it is actually very much similar to the polity answers which we write. The questions are very much similar to the polity questions. But what makes the difference is the answers which we write. Here we have to write very much conceptual answers, like which is actually with respect to Papad itself, like the thinkers. In case of Papad, I have to incorporate various thinkers into the answers. So answers should look like actually a public administration answer rather than a general studies answer. So this differentiation will actually differ subject by subject, but you should ensure that you are able to differentiate a normal GS answer from a public administration, optional kind of answer. So this is another area which I want to tell you. And apart from this, now coming, so this is about the, I think I have discussed all the seven subjects in the optional. Apart from that, you have the language papers, which is very much easy with the basic knowledge, 10th standard knowledge about the language papers, you will be able to do it very well. So, and coming to, I think I have missed the CSAT preparation in prelims. So I'll just briefly tell about the CSAT preparation. So in CSAT preparation, as you all know, there are three main parts, that is the mathematics, the quantitative aptitude, the reasoning, and the passage. So here my focus, I'm an engineer, right? So my focus was to focus on the areas of quantitative aptitude as well as the reasoning part. So I was getting a lot of negative marks in the passages. So I tried to minimize the questions which I wrote in passages, and I focused on quantitative aptitude and reasoning. So here also it depends on which is your strength. There are many people for whom passage is very easy and passage is their strength. So those people try to focus on passages. But if you are an engineer and if you are good in mathematics, then in that case, you should definitely focus on the quantitative aptitude and reasoning, so that you will be ensured of that 66.66 mark. Now, so we have discussed about prelims, you have discussed about mains. Now, coming to the interview preparation, so till prelims and mains, I would suggest that you should focus only on one newspaper. But coming to interview preparation, try to go more than one newspaper. One, two, or even three newspapers. So, like selectively, two, three newspapers you can do. In my case, I had actually read the Hindu in Indian Express. I started Indian Express also, especially the explained page in Indian Express. That was very useful for me. And Economic Times also, the editorials of Economic Times, I used to focus on. So this actually gave me in-depth knowledge about various subjects. Also, I had extra time due to COVID, postponement of the interview due to COVID. So I was able to focus on two, three newspapers at that point of time. Apart from this, the mock interviews are also very much important. So here, for my mock interview, I had again come to Shankarai's Academy. I had at least attended two to three panel interviews and even one-on-one sessions with various civil servants I had attended. So this was actually very much useful because the input which we get from the senior bureaucrats, that actually helps us to improve our confidence while answering our answering the way of answering, etc. So I was able to interact with the Ramachandran sir, who actually gave me two to three very important inputs which I had incorporated in my interview preparation, which helped me to improve my interview preparation. Okay, so try to attend around 4 to 5 mock interviews before you go to the actual interview, so that the fear of interview will go away from you. Also, you'll be getting very important inputs from your from the mock interview. So I'm very much thankful to Shankarai's Academy for providing me the kind of interview panels which I got during that interview preparation. So definitely try to attend as many mocks as possible as early as possible. It is not advisable to attend a mock interview just 2-3 days before the actual interview. This was a mistake which I made in the forest interview. During my Indian Forest Service interview, what happened is just 2-3 days before the forest interview, I went to an institute in Delhi and I tried to give a mock interview. But what happened was the panel was very much serious. They were very much serious and they were very much critical on the way on my interview preparation. They asked me a lot of questions and they even told me that they don't actually see some knowledge in me which would make me a civil servant. So that was very much demotivating just 2 days before the actual interview. But for civil service, I ensured that I stopped the mock interviews at least a week or even 10 days before the actual interview. So these are some of the tips which you have to focus on. And one important tip which Ramachandran sir told me was to ensure that the interview panel doesn't overpower you. You should be very confident. You should be very, very much confident in presenting your points. Even if they are telling against it, don't go into arguments, but stand with your points. So that is the important message with Ramachandran sir had told me. I had actually implemented it and I was able to actually see a lot of improvements after the mock interviews which I gave in Shankar. So apart from this, a lot of institutes will be giving mock interviews. So you can try diverse panels. So this is regarding the interview preparation process. And apart from this, all three of this, like prelims, apart from prelims, mains and interview, what I want to share with you is the mental attitude, the attitude which every aspirant should be having for this interview. Why I say this is important is because a lot of issues, you'll be facing a lot of issues during this long journey, long exam process of the civil services. At that time, what you have to have is the mental strength and attitude towards the exam. Why I'm saying this is I have experienced it firsthand. For example, in case of prelims, just a week before writing the prelims, I had written the full length test of two academies and I found that my marks are only 70 and 75. So you have to see that it is just a week before the actual prelims, I'm scoring 70. So then I thought it was actually a bit depressing. But here the mental strength comes into picture. I told myself that, see Nitin, you have scored 90s and 100s earlier. So there is nothing to worry even if you score 70s in one or two tests because that should not affect my actual prelims. So I just came over it and I gave the actual prelims and I scored around 120 there. Also during my mains examination also, I think due to taking a lot of stress, I actually encountered with health issues. While writing the essay examination, I actually I had low blood pressure and low sugar. I actually almost fainted. I had giddiness. I had to lie down on the bench for some time. So there were a lot of health issues which happened. So this continued with the GS papers also. So I was writing the essay and the GS papers with very bad health. Even with bad health, I was able to complete the papers because of the attitude which I had. I told myself that whatever comes, this is something very important which I have prepared for. I'll be writing the exam. I'll be giving my best. I'm not going to get sad because I got this health issues at this crucial point of time. Why I'm sharing you this is many of you, at least one of you might face some issue which is going to come during that exam process. At that point of time, if you are able to get some mental strength from my experience, I'll be very glad of it. So, and coming to interview, before my interview also, I already told that it was postponed due to COVID. There was a lot of uncertainty and all. So you need a positive attitude to actually cope up with all this stress, uncertainty which comes during the course of the preparation. So this is the main aspect, the positive nature and the mental strength which you have. Okay. So, so these are the main aspects which I have had to discuss with you. Now, I would definitely love to answer the questions which you are having. So, if you have any questions, please tell me. I will be very glad to answer it. Arun Lal, sir, you can take the mic.
Thank you so much, Mr. Nitin. You have been very, we are very grateful to you for the kind words. You have been telling about strategies like minimum books, maximum revision, and also ultimately, speaking about the positive attitude that any candidate needs to maintain throughout his preparation stage, being a very long journey, you have shared with it. Now, we will take a few questions from the candidates. So, you can throw up questions in your question answer. Already, we have got 2-3 questions. So, I'll ask the questions to Mr. Nitin. First one, what source did you refer for governance Is it important to read the second ARC report? Okay, so this is the first question by Ms. Indulekha Baby. So if you could answer this, Mr. Nitin. She's asking about governance.
Yeah. So for governance, again, as I already told you, like any other topic in the mains examination, syllabus should be the main thing. So under governance, there are a lot of subparts. I have already told e-governance to you. Apart from e-governance, there is citizen charter, and there is good governance, and a lot of other topics like that, right? So on these topics, just Google citizen charter, UPSC. You'll be getting a lot of materials in the internet. Make very crisp and short notes on those. Okay, and keep revising it again and again. And coming to second ARC, you can read it selectively. There are a lot of summaries of second ARC given by, like which are available in the market. So focus on the summary. But in my case, I had public administration as an option. So second ARC was very important there. So I had actually read some of the areas of second ARC completely. Again, it should be very selective. It is a very long document, very big document. Be selective in it and try to make very short notes so that you can revise it again and again. Yeah.
Thank you. I'll get the second question. Did you face any kind of questions related to corona pandemic in your interview session? It is asked by Mr. Albin Lonapan. So I think he's asking about the interview during the COVID times.
Yes, yes. I had got questions regarding COVID. The main questions are focusing on...
I think your interview was first day of COVID, no? I think, Mr. Nitin, your interview was first day after after the COVID interviews began, no? I mean, post-COVID interview. I think yours was the first day.
It was second day.
Second day.
It was the second day. It was on 21st. So actually, during the initial days of the day, first or the second days, definitely we expected questions from COVID. The questions which was asked related to COVID to me was regarding to my home status. They asked me how Kerala was affected by COVID. What is the effect on Kerala economy due to COVID? So I answered in such a manner that the tourism was affected. The remittance coming from other countries, it reduced. So here, while answering this, I ensured that I tried to say some of the statistics. Like if the tourism was affected, tell the statistics, what was the revenue from tourism in the last year and how much it had reduced. So it had reduced by around this much percentage, I should be able to say. Even coming to remittances, I should be able to say due to COVID, the remittance which are coming into the country and into the state especially had reduced by this much percentage. So these kind of statistics which actually will add weightage to answers. Also another question related to COVID was, how Kerala economy can revive from this COVID. Okay, so I told about Kerala should focus on its strength, especially in the areas of health sector, IT sector, etc. So that the excessive focus on tourism and other service sector will reduce and Kerala's strength can be utilized. So this, so I even told a catchy line which I actually found in some newspaper. Kerala is said to be God's own country because of the reason that, mainly due to the tourism aspect, right? So I told that Kerala should shift from being a God's own country to a healthcare's own country. So that kind of a shift is necessary. Also, if India is the pharmacy of the world, then Kerala should act as the hospital of the world. So these kind of, some kind of catchy, kind of a different answers I tried to say during the interview, and I think it might have definitely helped me to get a bit more marks in the interview. Actually, the interview was taken by PK Joshi, sir. The board was very serious. Even though I said these kind of points, they were actually very serious. They were not at all responding, but still I feel that I have done well in the interview. So these are the main questions which are related to COVID in the interview. Yeah.
Thank you, Nitin. Next question is asked by Shruti. Can you please tell the strategy you adopted for ethics paper? I think paper 4.
Okay, ethics is also another important paper where you can actually put in less efforts and get more marks. So that's why ethics should not be neglected. So here I would say the basic strategy should be again, as I told, minimum materials, maximum revision. Try to take one book, one standard book of ethics, and read it, revise it completely. There are a lot of books in the in the market, like Lexicon is there, D.K. Balaji is there. So these kind of books you can refer, any one book is sufficient. And for case studies also, try to refer to, like I had actually referred a bit of case studies from Subbarao also. So try to actually limit your sources to one or maximum two books. And apart from this, case, try to practice case studies a lot, because around 130 marks will be from the normal questions and around 120 marks will be from the case studies. So you have to actually give equal importance to writing the case studies also. While writing case studies, you have to, if it is preferable to follow a standard structure. For example, in the introduction, I'll be giving the crux of the case as the introduction. Then I'll be analyzing the stakeholders, who are the stakeholders involved, and what are the ethical issues involved in those with respect to those stakeholders. Then the various options which I can adopt, the positives and the negatives of those particular options, and the option which I am choosing. Another important aspect is the option which you are choosing, you should be able to justify with ethical theories. So assume I am choosing option D. So I should be able to analyze it with respect to the theories, various theories. Okay, with respect to utilitarianism, this will be the right step to do. With respect to categorical imperative of Immanuel Kant, okay, this will be an appropriate step to do. So in this manner, I should be able to justify my step, the option which I have chosen with respect to the various ethical theories. So try to bring a lot of ethical theories, ethical keywords, and examples into the answer. So ethics is an area where you can even use your personal examples also. The areas where you have encountered honesty, empathy, compassion, etc. in your personal lives. So these kind of personal examples can also be added in ethics. Apart from the other examples which you get from newspapers and even from the lives of great personalities. So, and try to add quotations into the ethics answers and try to be more philosophy oriented in the ethics answers. So these were some of the strategies which I followed in my ethics paper.
So thank you. I think that question has been clarified. Now we have a couple more questions. It is asked by Shiva Surya. In case of NCERT, from which class we have to read, either from 6th class level or from 10th class level?
So here, again, as I already told, it's preferable to start from the 6th standard NCERT itself, because the 6th standard NCERT is like history, geography, and all have a lot of content in it. Okay, and UPSC tend to ask questions from those NCERT. So don't miss any NCERT. Only if you have a paucity of time, then start from 10th standard NCERT, 10th or 11th and 12th. Okay, otherwise start from the 6th standard itself.
Yeah, a few more questions, Nitin, if time permits. So the next question is, when can I start preparing for UPSC, CSE? Being a college student, will preparing from now be good? I think a person has not given his name or his or her name. Please, the question is when he wants to prepare, he or she wants to prepare being in college.
Here also I would suggest that it is better to start the preparation as early as possible, because knowing the syllabus, knowing the demand of the question, all these things take a lot of time, right? So try to understand the syllabus and the demand of the exam during the college phase itself, because I've seen many people are doing that. Many people are even starting the preparation from the first year of college itself, and as soon as they graduate, they'll give the exam and they're able to crack it in the first attempt itself. There are many examples this year also. So if you have the chance to start preparation during the graduation itself, started even in my case also, I also started during my third year of graduation. It definitely helped me to crack my prelims in my first attempt. So even though I couldn't crack the mains, definitely cracking the prelims in the first attempt was definitely a confidence booster. It helped me during my later stages of preparation. So try to start as early as possible.
Thank you. I hope that question is answered. We are having a flurry of more questions. I think this is being a highly competitive exam, students have many doubts in their minds, and they would be really happy to have a topper able to clear those doubts. So one more question from Kirba Shankar. How much important it is to study the Yojana and Kurukshetra for civil service examination?
Yojana and Kurukshetra, they're actually excellent sources for civil service preparation. But again, here, it depends on the time which you have. If you have a lot of time, then you can definitely start preparing it. But what I felt was, in my case, the newspaper and a current affairs magazine was sufficient enough to cover my current affairs. But for interview preparation, I had gone through some of the Yojana magazine so that I'll have a more conceptual clarity. So it actually depends on the amount of time you have and how well prepared are you with the other subjects, the basic subjects. So Yojana is more like a value addition. So I would say, depending on your time and preparation of the other subjects, you can definitely go for Yojana and Kurukshetra. Like first I would prefer Yojana, then again if time permits, you can go through Kurukshetra also.
Okay, thank you. So what is your advice for aspirants preparing for UPSC while having a job in parallel? So I think it's a question by a working professional someone.
Okay, so this question, I wouldn't be able to answer it clearly because I have never did a full-time job, but I have definitely done part-time jobs and all during the course of preparation. So what I do understand that having a job is a very much tiring process. You will be, after completion of the job, you won't be able to open your book and study. So that is an issue with the working aspirants normally face. But what I would suggest is, if you can get at least 4 hours of preparation, 4 to 5 hours of preparation while doing the job, then it would be great. So here, time management becomes very important. Prepare for the exam during your most productive time. In my case, if I was a working professional, I would try to get up early in the morning, like 4:30 or 5, and I get around 2 to 2.5 hours of preparation in the morning. Then I go for job. Then in the evening, again, 2 to 2.5 hours of preparation. In this manner, you should be able to balance it with utmost discipline. So that is an important requirement if you're a working professional.
I hope he got few insights into that aspect. Now, we have a couple of similar questions, so I'll club it together. So how many hours we need to put in for successfully clearing the exam, whether there is 10 plus 6 plus 6 formula or another, I'll just add one more question which is similar. This question is asked by how to manage daily time schedule management, few words. And one more person, how to manage and schedule the preparation on a daily basis, something like that. So I think they are basically asking about how to manage the time daily.
Okay, regarding time management, here what I would say is, like, again, it depends on individual. There is no fixed time for which everyone can study. When I was a beginner, I couldn't study for more than 4 hours. Like, I would get tired by afternoon. If I started in the morning, I would get tired by afternoon. But still, I just continued that. I ensured that I studied for 4 hours, and slowly I started increasing my time. And I was able to get around 7 to 8 hours of preparation. So that was my ideal time of preparation. So here, again, one should focus that it's not the quantity of the time that matters. The quantity do matter, but apart from that, the quality matters a lot. How efficiently are you using this time which you have, that matters a lot. If I'm just sitting in front of a book, spending a lot of time reading very less content, it's like very less productive, right? So here, try to be productive in those very less hours which you are putting. Like if I'm putting 8 hours a day, I'll be at my utmost productivity there. That is my only aim. Okay. And apart from that, try to break this session throughout the day. This 8 hour, try to break it throughout the day. 1.5 hour early in the morning, 1.5 hour after breakfast, 1.5 hour, then take a half an hour break, then again 1.5 hour. Then after lunch, try to take a nap. If you take a nap, the benefit is that the rest of the day, after getting up, the rest of the day will be as productive as a new day. That is what I felt. So in that manner, again, some 2 1.5 hour sessions would definitely be sufficient for preparation of this exam. So short 1.5 hour sessions with proper breaks and maximum efficiency at the time you are studying. So this is what I would suggest for time management.
So thank you, Nitin. I think he has busted many myths that UPSC toppers will not take a nap or they will not sleep. They are like normal human beings who prepare. So I think that's a great piece of advice. Next, one more question. Somebody has asked, he's in third year of engineering, when I can prepare for UPSC. I think it is related to the degree question. I think he's in third year of engineering. So.
Okay. So here, again, see, you focus on, you have to focus engineering as a first priority because the minimum qualification to write UPSC is having a graduation. So focusing on civil service should not affect your graduation. Again, depends on how much marks you are getting usually. Because during the third and fourth year, a lot of things come into picture. You will have a final year project. you will have placements coming. So already a lot of time will be consumed for all these things. Okay, and there's a good chance of getting a backlog in, during those third and fourth year, because many of my friends actually got that. So ensure that, like, if you're a person who is consistently getting around 80%, and like, personally, I used to get 85%, my aggregate in engineering is 85%. So for me, it was not a big deal. Like, I was sure of not flunking in any subject in engineering. So if you have that confidence, then you can definitely concentrate on civil services. But if there is a chance that shifting to UP civil service preparation along with final year project placements and engineering, if it affects your, if it costs you to fail a subject, then definitely you should not try it. Don't try to balance it. Focus, primary focus should be completing your graduation. Then comes UPNC.
Thank you. We have one more question from Tirumalini. She is confused about choosing optional subject, how to choose it, whether based on short content or favorite subject. I think one earlier clarification was there, but I think if you could just clear a bit about this choice of optional.
Choice of optional. So as I told you already, the primary factor should be the interest in the subject. You cannot, because optional is a subject which has 500 marker weightage in the mains. And apart from that, you will be spending a lot of time in the on your optional. So choose the optional wisely. And regarding like primary factor being the interest, the other aspects which you can consider is concise syllabus. Another aspect you can consider is the overlap between other subjects. For example, in my case, when I took public administration, I came to know that it is overlapping with the GS2 paper. It will definitely help me in my essay paper. It will also help me in my ethics paper. So these are some of the other areas where my optional will definitely help. So these are some of the areas which you have to consider. Also the relevance of the subject. Public administration was very dynamic. So the current affairs which I am preparing for GS, I can utilize it in public administration. Also the public administration concepts, I can use it in GS answers also. So these are some of the aspects which I considered before choosing the optional. But here also, don't take any optional based on what another person is telling. Many people told me to change my optional subject because it is public administration and it is a low scoring optional. But still, I didn't change it because I was very much interested in that subject. Also, the effort which I have to put in another subject to change my optional, that would be humongous. And I didn't want to do that. So I continued with that. So if again I have to say concisely, it is your interest in the subject that matters the most.
Thank you, Nitin. With your permission, can we take a couple more questions? Like, I think they are having few doubts in their minds. So few more questions they are having.
Definitely. We can take any number of questions.
Sure. Thank you so much. So I think if you have any more queries, attendees can ask. I think we have got a couple more. This is the question about an edition of newspaper. Which edition of newspaper should we read for UPSC, like Hindu paper of Delhi or some other city, and how to omit unwanted news which is not asked in exams? It's about newspaper reading basics.
Okay. Fine.
One more question.
Coming to the
optional. Yeah. Sorry. Just one more question related to the optional which you are already answering. If graduating subject is not there in the UPSC, choose the optional. So maybe you can start with that and then enter the newspaper thing, because it was in continuation of the already
newspaper. Yeah. Okay. In my case also, the graduation subject was not there in the list of UPSC options. My graduation is electronics and communication engineering. So what you have to do is, see, you will already know from your school days and all which subject you are interested in. Whether you are interested in polity sort of things, history, geography, you will have an idea about it, right? So based on that idea, you should go through the syllabus of various optional subjects. From the syllabus, you should see the various keywords, various chapters in the that particular optional subject. Then briefly, if you can, you can read the various books, just 2-3 pages of any book, try reading it. And again, if you find it interesting, then continue with that subject. So that was the methodology which I used while choosing a subject which is different from my graduation. So I hope that doubt is clear. And coming to the newspaper reading, the edition doesn't matter actually, because you can go through what is available with you. And if you're going for offline subscription, and you will mostly get the edition which is available at your place, right? But if you are actually subscribing for online edition, you actually have the chance of choosing the edition. There, if you want, you can actually choose the Delhi edition or something. I actually used it only for the interview purpose. Like I read the Delhi edition of Hindu only for the interview purpose. Otherwise, I was actually using the edition of Bangalore. Okay. And coming to how to read the newspaper, ensure that I will tell you my method of reading the newspaper. I'll start with the first page. I'll read the important news which are there. Then I'll directly go to the editorial page. In the editorial page, on the left side of the Hindu newspaper, two editorials will be there. Those are the most important part of the newspaper. So those two editorials, if you can prepare notes also, that is fine. Only for those two editorials. Okay. And other than that, how you should choose, in the editorial page itself, there will be other articles. Okay. There also, you have to have the UPSC syllabus as your guideline. Okay. Try to link that article with the UPSC syllabus. Only if it is fitting, then read the article. Otherwise, leave it. Okay. So here you should have a thorough understanding of the syllabus in order to identify which article is important and which is not. Most of the political articles are not much important, but if it comes related to any laws, any the economy, those kind of things, it becomes more important. Okay, so first page, then shifting to the editorial page, then shifting to the next page, the news page. There is a news page there. That also you can read. Avoid the political news and all. Then go to the economy page. Then go to the international relations, international page. So in this manner, try to complete the important crux of that newspaper within 1 to 1.5 hours. More than this, you should not spend on newspaper. And it's not that much necessary to write notes out of it. Because if a news is important, it will keep on repeating for 4 to 5 days. At least 3-4 days it will be repeating. So reading it continuously for 3-4 days, it will actually help you to internalize that news. And when you are reading a monthly magazine, it will be like a revision also. So no need to make notes from the newspaper. It will consume a lot of time. Okay. So yeah, this is what I want to tell about newspaper. And in between all the local news centers, you can avoid actually. You don't have to read all the news which is there in the newspaper.
Just continuing a question about newspaper. I have been reading Indian Express for the last 10 years. Should I change to the Hindu? It's a question by Mr. Aravind. I think the choice of newspaper is a question.
Okay, so if you are reading and it's for last 10 years and if you're comfortable with the newspaper, then you don't need to change it. Because in Indian Express also, it's actually an excellent newspaper. The explained page of Indian Express, I was actually seeing that for the first time for my interview preparation. I actually wished if I could see it during my prelims or mains preparation. Actually, Indian Express is also a very excellent newspaper. Continue with that. There is no issue in, you don't have to change the newspaper if you are comfortable with it already.
Okay. I think eligibility for fourth year of engineering to write UPSC, I think he would be eligible, right? He or she. Fourth year of engineering. Final year graduates are eligible.
Yes, yes. They are eligible. If you have crossed 21 years of age, then definitely. Final year of graduation, you just have to show your graduation certificate before the mains. It is before the mains when you have to upload the certificates, right? So you can definitely write the prelims, but ensure that before mains you get the graduation certificate. So that is the only thing which matters.
One more question about how to effectively use the monthly magazines. I think that is one more question.
Okay. Monthly magazines, here again, focus on 12 months of monthly magazines and don't try to make notes out of it. As I already told you, use a highlighter and try to mark the aspects which are important for prelims and which are important for mains. I used to mark P for those facts which are important for prelims. I used to highlight it and mark P there so that when I come back for revision, I would be able to easily understand, okay, this is important for prelims, this is not important for prelims, so I can skip those aspects. So this kind of for revision, this will help you. And try to revise the monthly magazines at least 3 to 4 times. Before the actual prelim. That is very important for retention, because reading the monthly magazine once, it will not help you to remember anything. Okay, so try to revise it at least 3 to 4 times. And another important aspect is don't go behind new materials. You might think that, okay, in this monthly magazine, the content is not sufficient. I have to go to another magazine to cover it up. So don't give up to those kind of temptations. Believe in one magazine which you have followed, and believe in that institution which have created that magazine. Just believe in those, because the people who are creating the magazine, they are actually experienced. They are qualified enough. They know what is important, what is not important. So just believe in the magazine which you have chosen. Don't go behind a lot of magazines, and revise maximum from that one magazine which you have already covered.
Thank you so much. Just last couple of questions we would like to take. One is how to make effective notes for how to make notes for mains effectively. I think you have already covered it in your initial discussion. Maybe just a conclusion part about effective note making for mains.
Okay. So when I say about effective note making, what I want to say is to just make notes of the keywords. Okay, take a topic, if there are 5 to 6 keywords which are associated with it, then just note down that. If I take an example, okay, consider the case of citizen charter. It is a subject in the, it is a topic in the syllabus. So under citizen charter, what I'll be noting down is just a couple of points. Like, okay, it was started in 1991. John Major, government of United Kingdom, he started it. Okay, in India, Department of Administrative Reforms and Public Grievances. So this is a department which is focusing on citizen charter. So like this 3 to 4 points, okay, nothing more. You don't have to write it in complete sentences also. In my case, I used to actually cover at least four topics in one side of an A4 sheet. So in one side, 4 topics, I'll be dividing that A4 sheet into 4 subparts. So one quarter of a side of an A4 sheet will be one topic. That much thought was my A4 sheet. My notes. So this will actually help you to revise even in those times, like between the mains exams also. Like if GS1 is in the morning, the actual mains, actually GS1 in the morning and GS2 is in the afternoon, right? So in between those gaps, you should be able to revise. In those 2 hours, you should be able to revise your notes, right? So for that, I'll make this very concise notes. I already told you that my GS1, entire GS1 was only 20 pages. Similarly, the other GS subjects also was around 20 pages only. So this is the short notes making which I used to do.
The same person has asked whether it is important to study 6 to 8 months of current affairs or 1 year current affairs itself. I think about current affairs.
So current affairs, like for prelims, definitely 1 year of current affairs is important. Okay, people are actually referring more than 1 year also. But definitely more than 6 months of current affairs, definitely around 1 year of current affairs is a must. But when it comes to mains, so that time you can actually limit the current affairs. Like my mains was in September, and I actually focused on the current affairs which were there from January only, January to August. So, but definitely more than 6 months. Try to, for prelims, you need at least 1 year of current affairs. Try to do 1 year of current affairs.
So I think we have got some questions now. Just to conclude my general last question, any message to people who don't clear in their first attempts? How did you keep that motivation to keep fighting again and achieve the success that you have done now?
Okay, what I would say is, whatever happens, whatever bad thing happens, you should see it in a positive light. That is what you should see. See, if you didn't clear the prelims in the first attempt, then it is actually a boon for you, because you will get 1 year, one complete year to prepare for your second attempt. And you can definitely clear the second attempt with a very good rank. In my case, what happened? The first attempt I cleared prelims. I wrote mains. So by that, by the result came, it was January. And my next prelims was in June or something, right? So just I got 5 months, and in between I got distracted, diverted due to the failure of that mains. And I couldn't clear my second prelims. So what, if I wish something, I wish that I should have failed in my first prelims so that I would have cleared in my second attempt at least. Okay, so whatever comes to your life, you should see it in a positive manner. So that is what I would say. If you didn't clear in first attempt, you will clear in your second attempt. Be happy about it. Like, don't take failure to your heart. Don't take failure to heart. Whatever happens, see it positively. That's what I would say.
Any last piece of advice for those candidates who are giving the prelims this year? I think we have the prelims in another 40 days. So,
yeah.
How to keep the focus in this difficult time of COVID also? Because you are someone who has prepared for interview during this COVID time. So all those mental challenges would have come for you.
Yeah. Yes, yes. So I do understand that preparing during this time support is very difficult, because many of you might not be even having the hard copy of the books which you used to study. Many of you might not be able to go to the libraries. Like I am a person who cannot sit in home and study. I need a library to study and I need a peer group to study. But during the times of COVID, I lost all of that. Like no libraries, no peer group, nothing. We have to depend on ourselves. So this situation, I do understand. But again, you should understand one thing. You are not the only person who is facing it. This is a very relative kind of exam. Everybody is facing the same. And a person who is able to do relatively better will be able to crack the exam. So try to be that person who is doing better than the people who are around you. Okay. So I won't tell you to be perfect in your preparation and all. But try to be better. Try to have that positive mindset. Try to be better, relatively better. Okay. And apart from that, what I would say is regarding the last 40 days of preparation, focus on revision as well as test series. Don't go for new material. There will be a lot of syllabus which you might not have completed. Nobody completes the syllabus and clears the exam. Till now, I have not completed the syllabus of medieval India, ancient India, and a lot of other syllabus which I have never completed. But that doesn't mean that I won't clear the exam. Okay, so focus on revision. Don't go behind. Definitely, there are a lot of subjects which are not completed. Don't go behind that. Focus on the main pillars. Focus on the pillars like history, moral history, then environment, etc. Read the basic books which you already read. Revise them multiple times and try to give a test as frequently as possible. In my case, I used to give a test once in 2 days. Okay, there are people who give a test once every day. Okay, depending on your pace, try to give a test, because test is very much important at this last point of time. I have already told you, and try to stop giving the mock test 1 week before the actual prelims. Then just believe in yourself, have faith in yourself. Just go write the exam. While writing the exam, try to be very calm. Don't stress yourself up. Very calm. Just see it as another mock test. See the actual prelims as another mock test. Be calm. Write the exam. I want to tell you one thing. Like in my actual prelims, in my two prelims which I cleared, I was able to attend only 25 questions after 1 hour. So after 1 hour, only 25 questions, and I have to actually reach around 85 within the next 1 hour, right? So in these situations, these are the situations where fear will start coming to your mind. But you should ensure that you believe in yourself. You should think that, you should believe that you'll be able to do it. You should be able to complete it and clear it. That belief on yourself. When nobody is believing you, you should be starting to believe in yourself. Okay, parents might not believe you, friends might not believe you, but have utmost belief in yourself. This is the most important aspect at this point of time in the prelims is near. You can see, many of you might be fearing of failure now. You have enough time to fear about failure after your prelims. Okay, so till you write the prelims, you should be 100% sure that you are going to clear this exam at any cost. That should be the confidence you should be having. So this is my advice to you before this prelims. Yeah.
Thank you, Nitin. It has been an extremely inspirational session so far. We would like to wind up the questions with a very last question by somebody, Ragul. That is the last question in today's session. I'm weak in mathematics, so what should I do for CSAT? Any particular aspect about CSAT maths, he's asking. That is the last question we are taking for today's session.
Okay. If you are weak in maths, you should actually analyze your strength. Like, are you good in passage? Are you good in comprehension and reasoning? So if you're good in these two things, then focus more on this. And if you think that you have to improve your mathematics, then there is a book called Quantitative Aptitude by R.S. Agarwal. So that is the book which usually everyone uses to improve the quantitative aptitude. So just try to attend the examples which are given in those books. So that will actually help you to improve your mathematics. Otherwise, focus on your strength. If aptitude and comprehension and reasoning is your strength, play with your strength. You just have to get 66 marks. You don't have to score 100, 120 and all in that, right? Just score 66 plus. Like, for a safety, try to score 80 marks in that. Okay, so that should be your aim. And R.S. Agarwal is a book which I would recommend you.
Thank you so much, Nitin. I think it has been a very elaborate as well as informative session. In fact, it has been really motivational for all the candidates because you have taken us through the journey of how you overcame challenges related to COVID, also related to your failures in earlier attempts, because these are things which many candidates could relate to themselves also. They must have gone through similar situations, feeling let down and all, but words from toppers like you will be really inspirational for any such candidates. You have talked about maintaining the quality of time rather than putting in certain number of hours. Whatever hours are there, quality hours are important. Minimum books, maximum revision. You have talked about a very important aspect which is sometimes missed out, that is maintaining a positive attitude towards preparation. We are really sure that you as a civil servant would be taking forward that attitude into your job as well, and your career into Indian civil services as well. And from our side, we wish you all the very best for your upcoming service allocations. And we thank you from the bottom of our heart for your time for such a wonderful session for all the candidates. And we are sure that it has been really helpful for all the attendees. So thank you once again, Mr. Nitin. And we wish you all the best. Thank you to all the attendees. We look forward to having many such sessions in the future with Mr. Nitin as well. So thanks, everyone. Thank you for your time.
Thank you so much. And all the best for the prelims.
Thank you. Thank you, Nitin, for everyone. Thank you. So we are done with the session. Thank you.